Can we start? Hi, my name is Natalia Mikolska. I am Ukrainian Emerging Leader Fellow. Before that, I was 4 years Ukraine's Trade Representative Deputy Minister of Economic Development and Trade. I am a big believer in Ukrainian tech and innovation. I'm a big supporter of Ukrainian tech and innovation and a big promoter. Actually, I will tell you my personal story because we're in Silicon Valley and it's all about storytelling. When I first joined the government, I got my business card and my position in the government was translated not a trade representative, but a sale representative. So I think, you know, maybe it makes sense because like what trade representative has to do? It has to sell Ukrainian product and services abroad and bring investment into the country. So before we start, I want to do a pitch for my country in terms of tech and innovation. So let's start with a few numbers for you to consider. First one, Ukraine has the biggest and the fastest growing talent pool in Europe. The second very important issue, we have 23,000 IT graduates every year, which makes Ukraine a source of a tremendous talent pool. Ukrainian IT outsourcing industry and communication makes 3.4% share in overall GDP. Moreover, we have $2 billion in IT service export, plus for the last 10 years, we have 20% year-to-year growth, which makes this industry a very attractive for international investment. Moreover, every year we have a number of companies that work in IT industry growing. And 80% of these 4,000 IT companies that operate now in Ukraine are medium and small business. Moreover, we have 100 plus multinational R&D centers. More and more international and global companies are choosing Ukraine as the place and destination for their R&D center. Taking into account this big and fast-growing talent pool, plus what is most important, relying on the foundation that has been built by Ukrainian IT outsourcing industry. We have two unicorns. We have VC investment from Silicon Valley. Moreover, Ukrainian IT ecosystem is growing. As of today, we have 17 clusters and 13 IT associations in Ukraine. And last but not least, I think you've heard about these names here that we have. It's two unicorns, Bitfury and GitLab, AllSet, Augmented Pixels, Deposit Photos, Grammarly, Invisible IO, MacPo, People AI, PetCube, and Riddle. I'm so proud of these companies. Moreover, we had a few major acquisitions that you see down there. Livestream acquired by Vimeo, Luxury acquired by Snap, Oracle acquiring Maximizer, and Google acquiring Riddle. So all of this makes Ukraine a place for you to consider to grow your business with. But I'm from the business, and I really want business to talk about opportunities that we have in Ukraine. Therefore, we go now with a showcase of three Ukrainian startups that are here in the Silicon Valley for you to see actually what are Ukrainian startups about. I'm proud to have here today AllSet, People.io, and PetCube.
Hi, everyone. Hope like you're not too tired right now, but we will be really short. My name is Anna Polishchuk. I'm a co-founder and chief design officer at AllSet. And we are digitizing the restaurant industry by giving a busy people opportunity to pre-order their meals before they arrive to the restaurants for dining and takeout. And we've been live for about like 4 years, and we've raised $8.35 million from some prominent VCs like Andreessen Horowitz, Graycraft, Compound, FJ Labs, and others. And we are closing our Series B right now, and it will be announced soon. Olset is live in 12 cities throughout the US, and we actually are growing, we'll be like expanding really aggressive the next year, and having more than 2,000 restaurants on board. I can definitely say that Olset has amazing advantage of having headquarters here, but having also an R&D office in Ukraine. And what I want to highlight is not just engineers who we hire in Ukraine. Ukraine has amazing creative talent, marketing, business development, sales, and support specialists. And our team has 50% of this kind of specialists in our team. And I think that definitely US and Ukraine should use this opportunity of building this bridge for entrepreneurs and to do business together. And definitely not only Ukraine, but the US should benefit from it as well. Thank you so much. It was like a short introduction. I'm really happy to be present here and to be showcased among these amazing entrepreneurs. And I'm passing the word to the next one, Andrei. Thank you.
Hello, guys. So my name is Andrei Axelrod. I'm CTO, Chief Technology Officer of People AI. Previously to People AI, I've co-founded a company in New York called Smartling. So two words about People AI. We built revenue intelligence system. We work with sales, marketing, and client services teams to make them more efficient and to improve the top line so that people could sell more with our help. And we're doing it with AI, with artificial intelligence. So the company is currently, we've raised a couple of rounds with Andreessen Horowitz and Lightspeed. We are currently in San Francisco, LA, New York, and Kiev. Kiev is half our engineering Kiev, half our engineering team is in Kiev. So I've been asked to talk a little bit about why Kyiv and why Ukraine in general. And I think part of my answer was mentioned by Natalia. I think the short answer is amazing talent. We have 160,000 people who are working in the IT industry, and the competition for talent is just really insane. So we're looking at Bay Area, we're looking at New York. It's really, really hard to hire people, and you nowadays, I think you have to be a distributed company to be able to compete in this world, right? And so one answer for us is Kyiv. I'm doing it for 16 years at this point, working from United States with teams in Ukraine, and it's great experience. And on top of that, I would say Kyiv is a really, Kyiv and Ukraine really nice places to visit. So if there is a chance that you haven't been there, and you just simply must go and experience it. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Yaroslav Arznyuk. I'm a CEO and co-founder of the company called PetCube. While they're opening the slide, yeah. Here it is.
Clicker.
Yeah, and the clicker, thank you. So yesterday we had this dinner with some of the participants here in the audience, and someone complimented me for, oh, well, you're not just building a business, you're also caring about Ukraine. And I said, well, actually, it's the other way around. I'm building the business because I'm caring for Ukraine. And one of the things I'd like you to take from this panel is that I believe that building a business that creates value for the world is one of the most noble things you can do for humanity and is also a really important thing for your country. So with PetCube, we started this company about 7 years ago in Kyiv with two of my co-founders when my friend Alex was missing his dog so badly when he was away from home that he created the camera to see his dog remotely and made this camera with means of interaction to play with his dog with a laser pointer. So the products we offer are called PetCube Play, a camera with a laser pointer, and PetCube Bytes, a camera with a treat dispenser that allows you to remotely communicate with your pets. We are currently the world's leading maker of pet cameras and software for pet monitoring. We're also offering PetCube Care, which is a service that saves videos of your pet to the cloud, and Care Platform that uses artificial intelligence to analyze those videos and understand your pet, and then recommend them products and services based on that. PetCube has sold hundreds of thousands of devices. We've made tens of millions of dollars in revenue. We raised over $20 million in investment from various firms across the United States and Europe. We're selling across over 3,000 retail locations, including Best Buy, Bed Bath & Beyond, Amazon, SoftBank in Japan, about 18 countries around the world. So what is the learning? Oh, yeah. And our mission. Our mission is to connect pets to the internet and give them a voice. This is the coolest part. Sufficiently advanced technology is undistinguishable from magic. And once we can understand what animals think and feel, that's it. So what really inspires me to keep working and drives me forward on this adventure is when I see how much it inspires hundreds of Ukrainian entrepreneurs and frankly even outside of Ukraine, is one of these success stories, how you go after a really ambitious idea, create something valuable for the world, and end up with a success. So I hope that between Ukraine and the United States, more and more entrepreneurs, investors, business people will realize that if we merge the level of expertise and experience and managerial experience, very importantly, that is here in the United States, with the level of passion, radically new ideas, and vision, fresh vision, energy, and frankly, for the price of one engineer here in the Valley, I can hire five engineers in Ukraine. When you combine all of that, that's the recipe for success, and that's a recipe for how we're going to build the next 1,000 globally successful innovative companies. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So now we can commence our panel. I would like to invite our panelists to join me on stage. First of all, I'm very delighted to moderate this panel. A lot of people at Stanford and at CDDRL warned me because we have five panelists on the panel and they were like, you know, it's too much. Usually we have three or four maximum, but all the people that I have, they are either from business or from a startup environment, so they know how to pitch, so they know how to make their idea sound sellable in 2 or 3 minutes. So I really rely on this talent, and I hope that we will have a very encouraging, passionate, and interesting discussion. Just to introduce you my panelists, first one to my left is Olena Boitsun. First of all, Olena represents Luminate, which is the formerly known as the part of Omidyar network and went through rebranding. The thing that probably you haven't know, but you can look at our banner here, is that Luminate is a sponsor and actually financing our program, that we are very grateful for them. But what is most important why Olena is on this panel is her experience over 15 years of investment and management working in Europe, Asia, and US, and related actually to work with digital rights, digital democracy, AI, technologies, and Luminate is quite active in Ukraine. We also have, next one is my co-fellow, Ivan Primachenko. He is an educational technology innovator and co-founder of the largest Ukrainian massive open online courses platform, Prometheus, with about 1 million users. Structured as an NGO, Prometheus creates and publishes on its platform massive online courses for leading Ukrainian universities, companies, international organizations, and government. But what is most important, they are for free. So they can, you can access them and got all this knowledge and information. Then the next speaker that I'm very proud to introduce is John Song Kim. He's the founder of Five9 and Doctor Based, sold collectively worth over $2 billion and moved from Bay Area to Ukraine and Eastern Europe. In 2018, John started JetBridge, a software development agency that helps VC-funded startups in the Bay Area scale faster by leveraging Ukrainian tech talent. John, being not Ukrainian, is very passionate about our country. He contributes to Forbes and other prominent journals and newspapers writing about Ukraine and Ukrainian tech talent. Then I'm very proud to have on this panel Jerry Kaplan, who is widely known as an artificial intelligence expert, serial entrepreneur, technical innovator, and best-selling author. Jerry founded several technology companies over his 35 years career, two of which became public, and he also written several books on entrepreneurship and AI. He lectured and the research affiliate at Stanford, and I was taking his course last quarter. And I think that a lot of people that are here were like with me in this class. Last but not least, Vlad Voskresensky. Vlad Voskresensky, a CRM industry veteran, co-founder of Invisible IO. Invisible IO is sales engagement and revenue acceleration platform and solutions, changing the game for B2B sales. Prior to that, Vlad was CEO and co-founder of Afortio, software development company. He led the company to merger in 2008. And Vlad is very passionate about Ukraine and is promoting Ukrainian talent, startups, teams here in Silicon Valley. So I think that we will have a great discussion, but to start with, I would like to ask a question to Jerry. We're in Silicon Valley, all of us. We're in Silicon Valley now. We talk a lot about Ukraine, but first, in order to understand how we fit into the Silicon Valley with our idea, passion, tech talents, what are the trends in Silicon Valley? Where are we heading? What are the major, you know, is AI major driving force now? What the AI development mean for tech business, including IT outsourcing?
Well, asking what's going on in Silicon Valley, it's a little bit like saying, what's going on in New York? You know, so I'm a little not quite sure what to focus on. I could talk about some potential trends, but a lot of people might have different views on what the trends are. In terms of investment activity, certainly there's been a lot of investment around the field that's my focus, artificial intelligence, but I think it's broadly misunderstood as to what that means. Really, we're talking about selling software tools for analyzing large collections of data, which is much of what we heard a little bit about earlier. So there's a lot of applications of taking AI technology that's recently become more practical and applying that more widely to all kinds of industries and all kinds of applications. But every company that does that is in a different business, or in the pet business, or in the farming business, or whatever it might be. So that's actually a fairly broad area. The other big trend, which most people are probably aware of, is not necessarily a very positive one, which is, I think, that people have come to understand the last revolution in social media and in using the internet as a communications tool has been disruptive of a lot of things that we cherish here in the United States, like democracy. And so there's a lot of discussion and a lot of activity, particularly here at Stanford, in trying to understand what is it about that technology that is having these negative externalities, as they call it, negative effects on democracy and hate speech and all of that, and how are we going to mitigate that in the future? So as I said, there's a lot of activity taking place here to study, first of all, what are those effects, and then secondly, to come up with various schemes for being able to improve that without impinging on the very equally cherished right of freedom of speech here in the United States. So those are two trends. Recently, a previous wave of Silicon Valley companies have been going public in the past couple of months because the market's been very strong. So that's been getting a lot of attention. But I think it's really focused a lot of the outside the Silicon Valley attention on the problems that Silicon Valley is creating and how it's exporting Silicon Valley values and ideas in places where that may not be always entirely congruent with the attitudes of the local areas. So I'll just stop there.
Just a follow-up question. A lot of experts in Silicon Valley and in the world, they are talking that there is a huge race or even a war, AI war, between China and US, and small countries or even European countries, they do not have any position in this war. What is your view on that?
If I had to boil it down to one sentence, I'd say it's nonsense. But to understand why people are talking about this, first of all, everybody loves to, in the press, loves to generate up a fight, you know, some kind of, always. I remember when it was, in fact, it happened in artificial intelligence about 20 years ago, it was the Japanese were going to take over, the fifth generation computer project, and there was a huge to-do and lots of panels convened and nothing ever happened. But what's really going on is that artificial intelligence technology is extremely valuable in China for doing certain classes of things, and they're in a very good position to exploit the technology because it's primarily based on having large volumes of data, and in case you haven't noticed, there are more Chinese people than there are just about anybody else. In fact, I was shocked to discover that there are more English speakers in China than there are in the United States, just to put this all in perspective for you. But the government there has a major challenge, which is how to, what's the polite way to put this, how to shape the public opinion and how to ensure that any potential objections or threats to the power of the government is not allowed to grow. And AI technology is very good for being able to keep track of large groups of people, to know where they are, what they're doing, and to monitor all of their communications and to identify what they would be perceiving as threats. So it's very important to them. But that's not useful to us. And because it's all data-based on local data, you can't just take that and export it to the United States, and it's not really that useful necessarily outside of China. However, in the same way that technology in the United States, when it is exported, be that Facebook or Google or whatever it is, naturally brings with it a certain amount of influence on the ideas of the attitudes of people in this area, and of course has economic effects to draw profits back to this area, and it increases our influence and on the political activity and on the people around the world when these things are exported. The same thing is true for China, and China is now in a major push to export a lot of this technology, and there are a lot of places in the world that are more similar to China than they are to the US, where authoritarian governments really want to control their populations and accomplish these same results, which we find abhorrent here in the US, and though they're in the process of packaging up all this technology and selling it in the same way that the United States may sell arms somewhere, or you know, to Saudi Arabia or something, they're going to sell these packages of control to authoritarian governments around the world, and thereby have an opportunity to develop this strong relationship, to export their ideals, which are embedded in those products, and to have significant influence and sway around the world. So there's an economic competition, which is really what's going on, potentially, for the applications of artificial intelligence. And that's nothing new. There's always international commercial competition. So when whether we're dealing with high-speed trains or whether we're dealing with flat-screen displays, we're going to see the same kind of issues play out with regard to China and the US. But it's not like nuclear power that's something that can be kept in a bottled up through a non-proliferation treaty. You know, AI, anybody can study AI. Everybody in Ukraine can be just as expert as the people here in the US. It's very simple, very easy. The courses are available, the tools are available. And whether Ukraine has a place in this sort of mythical hierarchy of who's getting ahead in AI is merely a question of whether those tools are widely accepted and applied to various businesses like the ones we just heard about.
Thank you. Now I would turn to Ivan. The question is that we mentioned talent pool, the biggest and fastest growing talent pool. We have all of 3-hour showcase participants talking about the talent pool. But the question is that we see this projection of talent pool growing every year and Ukrainian universities contributing to that. What is your vision, like how you see situation in Ukraine with the engineering and technical education? Where are we heading? Whether we will have this talent pool projections and prognosis that we have now fulfilled?
Okay, great question. First of all, let's put things into the perspective. Last year, Stanford budget, just one American university budget, was basically the same as the whole education budget of Ukraine, right? So I think it's kind of impressive that Ukraine was able to generate such an impressive talent pool with such, you know, modest resources. And just imagine what Ukrainians can do with decent financing, with investments. I think it's really interesting thought to think about. And returning to your main question, I think that we have a few interesting trends, a few ways to characterize Ukrainian talent pool, right? First of all, it's important to remember that it's not only about quantity, it's also about quality, right? Ukrainians are talented. Just one example, last year, Ukrainian team won their 4th place on International Mathematical Olympiad, right? Just after the United States, Russia, and China. And you know, just we can just compare population size of Ukraine, around 45 million people, with the population size of China, and we understand it's kind of impressive by itself. But we also should remember that we are talking, when we're talking about this 160,000 people, right? We're talking not just about bachelors. Most of them have a master's degree, and a lot of them have PhD degrees, right? So, so these people, they can not just code some application. Often, they can help with applied serious research, and I think it's a huge advantage of this talent pool. Another thing that we should remember, this is quite diverse talent pool, because we have 160,000 specialists in IT, but Ukrainian engineering talent pool, it's not only about IT. Ukraine is really famous about aerospace engineering, right? About shipbuilding, about other areas like biochemistry, etc., right? So it's also interesting to think about it. And I think a really important trend in Ukraine right now is that Ukrainian universities, some of them at least, right, they try to create and launch new educational programs on the basis of best practices from Western universities. So Just a few examples. Ukrainian Catholic University, probably the best private university in Ukraine, a few years ago launched a master's program in data science, right? With a special focus on machine learning, machine vision, NLP, etc. They use active project-based learning. They invite lecturers from Western universities. They try to do applied research, not only teach students. And in other universities like Lviv Polytechnic University, they launched a bachelor's degree in Internet of Things. In Kharkiv Polytechnic Institute, AI bachelor program, et cetera. And finally, I think that's important detail about Ukrainian IT and in general engineering talent pool. Why I strongly believe that this engineering and IT talent pool will grow is a huge desire from Ukrainians to learn, right? Just one illustration, and it's a small illustration really. On Prometheus, a few years ago, we launched Ukrainian translation of one of the most famous in the world courses, CS50, Introduction to Computer Science from Harvard University. With the permission of Harvard University, we translated this course, published it for free, and more than 125,000 people registered on this course. Obviously, not all of them finished this course, but still you can understand this is really like a phenomenon in Ukraine. People really want to enter IT in most cases because of economic incentives, obviously. But still, people want to become engineers. And I think we'll see this trend more and more in the next 5 to 10 years.
Thank you. I think that's a very, a good overview of what we are having. I just had an idea after listening to our showcase participants, having Jerry on the panel and some other. Why not to create a course engaging the Stanford CDDRL on AI for Ukrainian tech people? We have, brilliant examples of using AI in tech. We have Jerry that knows and teaches a lot. We have John that knows how Silicon Valley thinks. So, I think that let's put all of our skin in the game and do something good for Ukraine as a result of the panel. I think that some people here that would be interested, just come to Ivan, talk to him, and we may do something good for the country. I would now turn to John. I actually, how I met with the John, that's a special story. I was reading Forbes, and there's this article coming up about Ukraine, and I'm just looking at the name, oh, wow, this guy has nothing to do with Ukraine. He's not Ukrainian, but he's so passionate about Ukraine. So what I do, I just check my Facebook and, look for this person and see that he knows so many of my friends in tech business. And I'm just like, okay, put me in touch with him. He's in San Francisco. We met. And I talked to him, and I saw that his story about how he ended up in Ukraine and what he is doing in Ukraine now is amazing. And he is among the best tech ambassador of Ukraine here in Silicon Valley. So, John, tell us your story.
Thank you. Well, first, I have to say I'm honored to be on the same panel with you, Jerry. Founders like me really came walking on the shoulders of this generation of pioneers and innovators. No, really. But I want Jerry to explain to us later why Elon Musk is scared that AI is going to kill human beings while Alexa can't understand my fiance's Ukrainian accent. We're going to have to figure that out as we all worry about AI. I have a little bit of a different perspective because I'm the dumb foreigner that came to Ukraine not speaking Russian. As we try to hire more engineers, designers, QA people, I actually think, yes, there's 180,000 developers in Ukraine, but I think how many of them could work in a Silicon Valley startup as a peer, not seen as, oh, you're the cheap outsourced labor, but you're our peer, I think about 3,000 to 5,000, about 1 out of 40, 1 out of 50. What we're doing is we're interviewing about 40 to 50 folks to hire for one position. So if I think about the potential for Ukraine, we look at, say, 40 to 50 CVs that we speak to. We choose one. But out of those 40 or 50 CVs, half of them are technically competent. I've never been to a country with so many technically competent young people that don't have the soft skills required to work at the highest levels of a VC-funded startup or the division of a innovation lab at a Fortune 500 company. So what I'm excited about is I feel like Ukraine's just at the cusp of going from a service outsourcer economy to an innovation economy. And so I'm excited to be there just at the kind of start of it. And I thank the political leaders for showing up here. I found their answers wholly inadequate. And it's something I say to my Ukrainian fiance a lot. Like, one of the things that really bugs me the most about having challenging dialogues in Ukraine, even with my own employees, is you ask a tough question, and instead of answering it with data or a yes, no, I don't know, it's answered with a long history lesson, which I think was showcased by the six or seven political leaders here. So thank you to them for preserving that great Ukrainian tradition of not answering the question and instead giving us a history lesson. I think the real leaders are right there. These three CEOs, they're the real heroes of Ukraine. The politicians, excuse my French, I don't trust for fuck all to do anything in the future. But this generation of entrepreneurs, I see them actually lifting up the GDP, providing jobs. You guys know, it's hard to hire people with the right mentality. You have to almost deprogram them like they came to you from a Soviet cult, right? And some of their longstanding beliefs, like work ethic, ethics, risk, and hard work don't equal more money, so why would I do that, right? What equals more money is connection and corruption, because those are the examples that I have, right? And so this generation of young entrepreneurs, and they're not all in tech, they're the ones that are actually being mentors and deprogramming the young generation to say, no, your reputation is actually more important than money. There's this thing called stock options. Here's why you want it, right? Seek mentors, right? Like, it's worth more to work at a startup where you get paid $500 a month less, but to have a good mentor, than to work for an outsourcer where you're going to work on a Java-based. Can you imagine a Stanford CS student programming in Java? But tons of Ukrainians do it because it's the technology language of a servant class, right? Because who comes to Ukraine to provide the most jobs for outsourcing? Norwegian banks. They have a banking application that's 20 years old, built on J2EE. No young Norwegians want to work in J2EE. We certainly don't here. So who does it? Oh, get the Ukrainians, they'll do it. And so you have a young Ukrainian guy thinking, I could work for Yaroslav, and it's on Python and Go and all these new technologies. But God, I got to work on Saturdays, maybe some Sundays too. I could just work for Seeklum. Yeah, it's J2EE, but I'm making $700 a month more. That's what I'm going to go for. So this generation of, to me, heroes are the ones that are actually on the street level, mentoring, teaching, and deprogramming, right? So that's, hats off to you guys. I think we will see far more results in the future changes of Ukraine coming, the more we can support them and not whatever the talking heads up here were before I got up here.
Yeah, I think that. That was a Silicon Valley perspective on what we had, which is honest, harsh, but that's what we need to hear and what the people need to hear, that You know, but John, do you still believe, I mean, while you are in, you are still in Ukraine, so you still believe that you can like decode and deprogram these people for the advantage of your company and for the advantage of like the whole economy?
Absolutely. We have, I have four young people now that, three men, one woman, and they are as good as anyone I've worked with here in Silicon Valley. You know, in my first company, we had 650, 700 employees. I've hired from Stanford, Berkeley, Carnegie Mellon, and in Kiev, they are just as good. Soft skills, everything, they are just as good as here. When I look at 40 CVs and we select one, the other 19 that were capable can do it. They just need a mentor that can teach them some soft skills training and deprogram them from some of their kind of what I call Soviet legacy beliefs, right? And like Yaroslav and the other two CEOs here, act as kind of good examples, right? Because in Kiev, you see a young person drive up to the club in a Porsche, and immediately everyone's thinking, oh, he's part of the government, he's an oligarch's son, the oligarch stole a bunch of money, that's how he got the Porsche, or he cheated someone, or he's doing something shady. There aren't enough good examples yet where they say, hey, this company was sold, and now there's 55 young people that are kind of living the life that you want in a few years. And they stayed in Ukraine, right? But am I bullish? Absolutely, because, you know, I think it's just about soft skills education from my, you know, sliver of IT. And when that happens, I think some amazing things are going to happen to both the GDP, but also just to the technical influence that Ukraine has on the world. Just one last thing in terms of dollars and cents, my top two developers in my Kiev office make $7,500 a month and $7,000 a month. The difference between that developer that makes $7,000 a month and another Ukrainian developer that's making $3,500 is all soft skills, right?
So we need to work hard on the soft skills.
I think we just need to bring more people from the West to act as good mentors. We need to support more young entrepreneurs like these folks here. And yeah, I mean, I think some magical things are gonna happen, right?
Okay. Olena? Yeah. Omidyar and Luminate works across the globe. You choose very carefully the destination that you actually launch your project, and Ukraine is among the countries that you are working. What are the projects that you have in Ukraine, and why actually you choose Ukraine for Luminate to start its activities in, and what Ukraine could contribute globally in terms of the data and digital rights, your major project that Luminate works globally?
Thank you, Natalia. It's very my pleasure to be here, and I think it's just the last panel, so I can really say that it was an amazing conference. And I just would love to congratulate Ukrainian Emerging Leaders Program on this, on launching this. And I heard, as Mr. Fukuyama said, that it will be an annual project. So I think we'll be all looking forward for finishing of this conference, but also the, well, the next events we are going to have. So as Natalia pointed out, so we are a global firm, which means, of course, that we need to work worldwide and we need to cover all regions, including Central and Eastern Europe. What is probably uncommon for other foundations and funders working worldwide is that, well, the head of our Central and Eastern Europe region is based in Ukraine. So I'm director for that region. And our founder, Pierre Omidyar, is the founder of eBay. And this means that even if our regional teams are based in the regions and our strategy and execution is also managed in the regions, our funds are still coming from Silicon Valley. And Pierre Media is a big believer in the concept of impact investing, which means that we have a pleasure of flexible capital. So we can do hybrid investments, we can do both for-profits and non-profits. And of course, when you develop market and develop ecosystem, it's a very crucial point. We work quite a lot in Ukraine. It's a priority country for us for the whole region. For many aspects, I think our panelists also mentioned a lot of them. First of all, of course, it's a brilliant big country with a huge population. And of course, if we want to be catalytic, if we want to be impactful, it's necessary to have a great market for this. And since our conference is called Ukrainian Democracy, I would love to bring some examples from our portfolio that specifically shows how technology can contribute to the country's development. And I was very pleased to hear in the reforms section the calls for Prozoro procurement system and Dozoro monitoring portal, which the projects we supported for Transparency International Ukraine. But something I wanted to highlight that actually we speak about them as reforms, but for us it's also the products. And the interesting thing for us that we support also global movement for standards for open contracting. And this global organization once received a message from Ukrainians that they need the standard for international procurement because they're building the product of procurement system. And since we supported both the global and the local teams, we know that this local project, Ukrainian one, is now that product that is showcased in all countries worldwide as the best project using this international standard. I think this is a really great win for Ukraine from technology side, and I would just really love to showcase it as a possibility for everyone. And since we were talking so much about IE, and really IE is a subject that we deal a lot, and we have a very wide portfolio on any automated decision making, IE, especially and on ethical side. We just have a very fresh project with Kyiv Smart City NGO and the Kyiv City Administration, which I'm sure will highlight Ukrainian experience using IE a lot. So it's called IE for Kyiv, and it's meant to implement the automatic decision making into the services of Kyiv City Administration, but taking into account also like no biases, no discrimination, and completely transparent algorithms. And I just would love to highlight that this is the first case in our portfolio worldwide that government allow it for civil society and for some programmers to assess the data and to develop this algorithm. Because usually it's made differently. Government implements some AI into the systems, and then some scandal, for example, appears, and civil society need to react. Or even if the government asks the feedback, it's still quite late sometimes. So, of course, it shows also the great willingness, first of all, for Kyiv City Administration and the Mayor Vitaly Klitschko to experiment with this. But also for us as investor, so whatever will be results for Kyiv Smart City project, it will be already innovative and international case for everyone on using IE in governmental systems. So just to sum up, I think Ukraine has really all the internal resources to be very prosperous and prosperous on the path to innovation, but it needs, of course, all the elements of this. And the capital, especially flexible capital, is something that is very much needed. It goes from venture capital to impact investments, and when Natalia was mentioning then we all go into pitch today, I thought like, okay, but I'm hearing pitches like literally every day of my life, believe me. I worked there for 4 years and I probably heard like thousands of them. And by the way, our pitches were really great. That's why you established businesses now, I think. But I also understood actually that I pitch it also every day, for example, for our co-founders. Because if you want to do something practical, you are here in Silicon Valley. You do meet people you want to attract capital for. It could be foundations, it could be impact investors, it could be venture funds. please ask them, why don't they use with Ukraine? Why they don't engage with Ukraine directly? Why don't they want to support projects there? Because the reality is, and I know statistics of the branch very good, the reality is that Latin America projects get a lot of support and flexible capital. African projects get a lot of support. Myanmar gets a lot of support. But even Western Europe, where you can imagine they have a lot of their private capital, but not our region in Ukraine specifically. So I think it could be, again, the practical case. I would love to motivate everyone. Let's pitch Ukraine also as a possibility for any investor who is not working there yet. Just mention this for friends, and yeah, I'm sure we can attract as much capital of different kinds as possible.
Thank you. Just to follow up on that, would you be ready to co-invest with some impact investor from Silicon Valley? Should there be the project, you know, that would fall in your criteria? Why I'm asking that? Because what I hear in Silicon Valley, usually they are looking for co-investors that already had an experience, have their skin in the game in the country. Would you be ready to do that?
Well, it's our requirements as well. We also usually ask for co-investors, and you can imagine how much pressure it is on me compared to other regional directors when I still need to have co-founders, but they are not in Ukraine in general. So technically, yes, of course, we need to discuss this, and this is practically what I really try to do through different associations, for example, for impact investing, and I do have some closed initiative in Ukraine on impact investment. So how to bring this understanding for foreign investors working there? Because in Ukraine, frankly speaking, we speak a lot about direct investments or portfolio investments, but the capital market is much more than this, really. And I know this because I work with my colleagues in US, I'm quite often here, but I'm based in Ukraine and I'm tackling jet lag now, so I do understand also all the challenges that any investors would experience in Ukraine. And I'm happy to share both the opportunities but also risks, because we need to be frank with everyone.
Yeah. I think that's a very important thing, to be frank here in Silicon Valley. People don't like, pardon my French, bullshit here around. So you need to be very precise, concrete, and, you know, like just like call the things how they look like. You know, don't say like gray and white or gray and black. Just call them white and black. Actually, I think that this Kiev City project could be an amazing project for Jerry to look into for teaching his course, because AI looking in a municipal sphere, I haven't heard of anything like that before.
I just would love to use this opportunity to invite you to Kiev, probably, and to experience it yourself. I think it would be really interesting.
Thank you.
And now I would turn to Vlad. Vlad heard a lot here. Vlad is a Ukrainian, a founder, being in Silicon Valley. And I would like you to share your story, how you end up here, what you are doing here, what is your vision, what Ukraine can bring to Silicon Valley, and what Silicon Valley could bring to Ukraine.
Okay, well, thank you. Well, you know, what Silicon Valley can bring to Ukraine, we've already heard, like, in very detailed and very, you know, passionate speech from John. And you know what, like, well, I've noticed that in that list of the speakers, I was actually included into the one of those presenters of, you know, the company presenters. And then it feels like, you know, like, you know, in the airlines when you were being upgraded to the business class at the last moment. So, like, thank you for that. So here I'm on the panel. And then once I've heard that opening speech from you, John, then I thought that nothing is senseless. I'd like to talk about that. We're going to have an interesting discussion on that panel. So my story, yeah, I'm Ukrainian born. I am Ukrainian educated. So I'm one of those thousands of IT professionals which Ukrainian universities are preparing every year. By the way, Ivan mentioned this, those nice kids, literally, from Ukraine who won the fourth place at the programming Olympiad. It was my teacher who prepared them. He didn't prepare me to that level. I never won anything like that. But I'm still thankful for him. So my career started as a software developer, very similar. We were in software outsourcing business. The first company we've built was software services. We managed that company to be acquired by New York Stock Exchange, huge provider, back in 2008. And we kicked off our product company. We started to build that product company out of Kiev, Ukraine, using our missing soft skills. managed that to be, you know, sold successfully here in the US, licensed by many giants like Microsoft, Oracle, SAP, Salesforce. They white labeled that technology, and then they're using this in their products. Keep doing that. We still have R&D office in Ukraine, and this is not just developers. It goes way more than that. So when I, like, back to your question, what do I think could be, you know, this win-win connection between, I wouldn't say Silicon Valley, let's say, like, United States and Ukraine? Obviously, this is this unique connection of a talent and ability to execute from business standpoint, technical talent and ability to execute from a business standpoint. If you would, this nice connection of a soft skill and hard skills. And once I've heard you, like, explaining the Ukrainian reality, it was a flashback to me because it was my voice, like, 5 years ago. I would literally talk on every Ukrainian event, like IT event, and encourage people, like, stop doing outsourcing, quit that, you know, sell of G2EE development because you get nice dollars or whatever is in Norwegian business, like euros, right? You know, start doing something yourself, etc. I should say that the beauty of Ukraine, one of the beauty of Ukraine, is that it's a really fast-changing country. And if you go to Ukraine right after the Soviet Union collapsed back in 1991, you'll see one country. Now it's like it's a very short time from historical perspective. We live through different transitions, significant transitions. And if you think that you know, like we came out on streets to fight for democracy like no one in Europe does it these days, right? And if you think that Ukrainians are different in offices, not really. They are changing very fast as well. So now I know and I see that it's much easier to hire people in Ukraine which has those soft skills, but thanks God they did not lose those hard skills as well. And I agree with you. I mean, it's still a challenge. It's by far not yet Silicon Valley experience when every candidate has excellent soft skills and you really, you know, kind of look for this unique combination of a technical talent. In Ukraine, it's still not there. But just a small example, we were chatting with my colleagues, with Lala and she, with Anya, sorry, and she said, hey, we are moving all of our support office from New York to Kiev. And I've asked her, like, is this, like, because of the cost efficiency? And she said, no, quality. They do it better in Kiev. And I was like, wow, how about English? And she said, like, it's perfect English. Well, to the restaurant business, but still, though, it's you know, good language skills, good soft skills, because in support, that's what you need to show. That's not a lot of a technical skills. Anyway, so I think that this is this unique, still unique combination of what Ukraine can bring to U.S. and what U.S. can bring back to Kiev, back to Ukraine. It's, you know, the ability to build the business from here, the ability to fuel up the business from technology side out there, and like marrying those things together, sometimes even literally, yeah, I know those cases, but literally like gluing those things together when you not only use the arms of Ukrainian developers, but also use their brains. Sometimes you need to help them to unlock themselves, but often they're already ready to that, and they've been through many changes in their life that they're ready to do it quick. Helped us a lot in our business, and that's, I think, what could be really scaled to, you know, much global effect than just for our company, just for Invisible AI.
Thanks. Thank you a lot. I think that we will have a great talk now. We have rather unconventional panel because, like, then we have five panelists, and our panel is the last one. So I just changed a bit the, you know, like the rules of the game, and what I suggest is, you know, and John just mentioned it, so every panelist have a chance to ask one question to the other panelist on the panel, and then we will open the floor to all others. John, you already had a question. We can come back to that. If you want to repeat it, you had a question to Jerry about Tesla.
Oh, I that was kind of a joke.
Yeah, but, yeah, no.
Well, I do have a question, so, excuse me. You know, whenever I pitch my bitch, it's an American phrase for saying you're complaining and you're not being polite about it. Whenever I complain in an honest way to my fellow Ukrainians about how hard it is to hire, I do get this reaction a lot. Well, John, I don't know who you're talking to because we were successful. My cousin Yuri, he was successful. He has no problem hiring. But then when we really sit down, we like start drinking a few beers and we say like, well, how many people do you interview, right? They say, oh, well, this many before we choose one. And I say, well, that's how many I go through, right? I was speaking to one of the guys from MacPaw, incredibly successful Ukrainian software company. A lot of you may use it, not even knowing if
and
you have a MacBook.
And they are also contributing to our program, so they are supporting our program.
They said some of our positions will go unfilled for a year. And as you know, being a successful tech entrepreneur, to have a critical position, almost any position, unfilled for a year means you're not hitting that gap to market that much faster. I guess my question is, are foreigners not looking in the right place? Or I guess that's not, is, do you feel like foreigners that come to invest in Ukraine and provide jobs in Ukraine, is it harder for us than it is for you?
Well, I don't know if it's harder or not. I would say that I'm not disagreeing with you in its entirety. I get what you say, and I'm telling you it was my speech 5 years ago. My point is that the gap is probably half closed already, and then how we are doing in our company, when we also have the challenges, like some of the positions which I would probably prefer to have it in Kiev, closer to those guys which are there, because we have offices here and there, etc. The trick which worked for us a lot was we would then grab, you know, the American employee and move it to Kiev for some time or even for nearly permanent time. And that would be a blast, right? Because those soft skills from him with the combination of the hard skills of the, you know, the local Kiev office, or, you know, the guys in Kiev office, help them to unlock themselves, help them to understand better, et cetera, et cetera. So if we cannot, you know, close the open position in Kiev office, we'll just move someone from the United States there. That's what we would do. And again, I'm not like arguing with you that that's the problem. I'm saying that it's a challenge, it's not a problem. However, though, I've seen this in the last 3-5 years that literally it's getting more and more and more improved, or like better and better. So I have a question to you, though. If you would go back in like 3-5 years and you would be able to reconsider your go to Ukraine, don't go to Ukraine, knowing what you've been through for today, will you do it or not, and why?
Well, my future wife is sitting right there, so I'm gonna default to say yes. It was the best decision I ever made. You know, it's funny because I'm ethnic Korean and I grew up in California, and so wherever I go in the world, you know, I kind of have this like I don't want to call it racism meter, but you feel like pockets of like being comfortable or uncomfortable. I don't know why, and we talk about this sometimes, but Ukraine's president-elect is Jewish. I mean, a lot of people don't talk about that, but Ukraine is one of the most, one of the least racist places I've ever lived or spent time in. I mean, people just welcome me with open arms. I go to a small town like Nikolaev, people ask me where I'm from. Like, people don't give us a hard time because we're an interracial couple. They don't give us nasty looks. And believe me, there are parts of the United States, tend to be more red states maybe, nothing wrong with that, where, you know, as an Asian man in an interracial relationship, you get looks that are not looks of kindness. But I've never had one of those looks in Ukraine, never. And it's funny because my friend, Guy Raphael, who was the head of R&D for MacPaw, he's black. And so we were having a beer in Kiev one day and I said, you know, this is like one of the least racist places I've ever lived, but you're black and you're huge, you're like 6'4". Everyone sees you, what do you think? And Guy said, you know, I haven't really thought about it, but yeah. This is like one of the least racist places I've ever been in the world. And I don't know what it is about Ukrainian people or culture, but they're so warm and open to new experiences and new people. I don't know. I think it's one of the hardest things I've ever done. I mean, look, I've built a NASDAQ public company. I've built a health tech company, which was even harder than that. This is probably the hardest thing I've ever done. But I feel like socially with my friends, my future wife and family, the incredible mentees I get to mentor every day, I think it's the best decision I've made.
But now you keep hiring in Ukraine.
Oh, absolutely.
So why would you continue that? Like, you think it's...
Because the people we're able to successfully deprogram are amazing. They're amazing. And that's the thing, it's like they cost, right? And look, I'm a business person, so at the end of the day, you know, it's a dollars and cents thing. I mean, look, you're hiring a developer here with 5-7 years of experience. It costs $220,000 plus taxes, plus workers' comp, plus if they have a kid, health insurance is $1,000 a month. And if you can mentor someone that can have that same level of output for literally 1/9 of the cost, I mean, there's, you know, literally millions of reasons to be in Ukraine.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Vanya, do you have a question?
Yeah, actually, I want to ask Jerry about AI education, you know, for common people. And I mean, you know, outside of IT community, when people hear AI, they think about general AI, right? Like about human level AI, which wants to enslave the world and all this stuff, right? And we, inside the IT community, do understand this, okay, we're talking about just specialized applications to solve very specific problems, right? And it's really challenging to understand what is AI, how it builds, how it makes decisions, and how it will probably influence future of society. But it's important for society in general to understand it, not only for IT community. How do you think we can teach society in general, not only in Ukraine, I mean worldwide, basics about AI?
Well, this is Natalia's had to listen to me talk about this 90-minute lectures for every week for let me try to boil this down a little bit. AI has a PR problem.
Yeah.
Okay. The impression that the general public has comes from fiction, television, 50 years of robots running amok and taking over the world and all of this. And this is what in the field is known as AGI, which is artificial general intelligence, which is little more than a hope or a fantasy and is utterly disconnected from the actual people who theoretically are doing AI. That's a software technology engineering discipline that's sort of like database management. It's really, in my view, it's very similar to what I saw happen with the advent of relational databases and database management systems. You saw exactly the same patterns, exactly the same type of use. And today you can't buy an application, or you don't use an application that does not have a database component in it. And it will probably be the case in another 20, 30 years that every system will have an AI component in. But it's kind of a misnomer in that regard. So, I mean, the difference between AI and AGI, even though they share two letters, is like the difference between wolves and werewolves. You know, one is a reality. You know, we can talk about wildlife management of wolves, but you don't then turn around and go, okay, now what are we going to do about managing the werewolves? There aren't any werewolves. There's no AGI, and it shouldn't be part of that conversation. So I have actually tried to promote that point of view. Let me give you a little insight into this. Everywhere I go, all the time, around the world, I speak. I've had no impact whatsoever. So this is so deeply embedded in the public consciousness that artificial intelligence, oh, robots, they're coming to take my jobs, you know, all kinds of crazy ideas, and you can't do anything about it. So the unfortunate answer, which I think will happen because this is a replay of a previous generation of this whole thing that we went through this entire cycle another time in my lifetime, is all of a sudden people go, well, that AI stuff, it never happened. It never started to work. I never had a robot come and take my job and, you know, all this kind of craziness. And it'll just fade into the woodwork and nobody will be talking about it in 5 years. And the technology will go on. It will continue to train people in machine learning and all the good things. But you know, don't be surprised if the general public, as you put it, somebody asks you in 10 years, yeah, whatever happened to that? You know, I think it will simply fade out of public consciousness and a way to be reawakened another day with some new wave of technology, which is also equally misunderstood.
Do we have more questions on the panel, or should we jump into the people?
I do have one.
Yeah.
John. You never answered her question. How did you come to be in Ukraine?
Oh, my God.
You know, answer with a history story. This is okay. This is the time.
Well, my, this history lesson is really embarrassing. Loneliness. You know, my CTO and I, we had done an IPO in 2013, and we sold our second startup in 2015. And we thought, you know, we're working 7 days a week. When we have this magical IPO and we make money and we're going to be driving a gold rocket car, suddenly we nerds are going to become popular. And actually, that didn't happen. So my CTO, Misha, said, you know, my ancestry is Ukrainian, but I don't speak Russian. I've never been to Ukraine. Let's take the engineers and go on a holiday in Ukraine. And I was like, are you nuts? There was this whole, like, Maidan thing I read about, and, like, what? There's going to be... I actually heard one of my friends say, aren't there grenades falling out of the sky? That's a direct quote. Aren't there grenades falling out of the sky? So I thought, oh, my gosh, this is, like, okay. But look, you know, everyone worked really hard. We'll go. And, you know, I think what I was saying earlier about, for some reason, Ukraine feels like the least racist place I've lived in. It was just such an incredibly warm place. And I, you know, it's funny, one of my engineers, the second day we were in Ukraine, this is a true story, he came to my hotel room to go to breakfast and said, hey, what happened last night? I said, what do you mean? He said, this cute girl walked up to me and asked me where I'm from. He's like, that's never happened to me. You know? It's never happened to me. No one ever comes up to me and asks me where I'm from. So I think part of it was the big fish in a small pond thing, right? We thought, oh, man, we had an IPO, and we're nobody still in San Francisco. You know, nothing's changed. We're still playing Xbox on Saturday night. And here we are. People think we're cool just because we're from California. Oh, yeah, this is. So we made the mistake of conflating pleasure and business and thought, we love it here so much, let's start a business here. It's going to be amazing. Oh, and it's going to be as easy to hire people here in Ukraine as it is in Silicon Valley, right? I mean, everyone's the same everywhere, right? So that's how we, you know, started this adventure.
Yeah. Very good. Thanks.
Olena, you have a question?
A short comment and a question also. So first of all, I think to continue what we discussed on soft skills, I think we all agreed that Ukraine has a very soft culture, and that's why I understand why, for example, support centers will be very, very efficient in Kyiv, because people will do care for all the requests mm-hmm. that will come up. So I think with soft skills, what is lacking is mostly the pitching, you know, like this very hard, very precious understanding how impactful, how valuable the work will be. So Ukrainians tend to say, like, oh, my English is not so good. Oh, you know, like, we didn't track anything. Our products, we produce it only 3,000 or something. So it's really, it's crazy from this kind. So I think the soft culture is really our advantage if we collect this kind of points. And coming to this, I think we have also very soft discussions on AI, because the last one I participated in international perspective concluded with the decision that ethical AI will be the one that will kill more than, well, less than half a population because of the ethicals. You know, like, if it's ethical, it will be more than half of people's lives still. If it's not ethical, it's to your point what you mentioned. So. And I think what I read is with MIT is that they practically do now the term on machine behavior. So do you think if Ukraine has a soft culture, so do you think our machine behavior will be also softer than other nations, or it's not possible?
Is this question for me?
No, it's for Jerry. Yeah.
I'm not sure I have it yet.
Do you think that the human culture of the experts who build some systems, for example, on algorithm, on automatic decision making, will it influence the way that well, algorithm will do decisions as well. So if Ukraine has a quite soft culture in general, will it mean that our, well, our systems will be more ethical and yeah, transparent, ethical by default, yeah.
Well, I think the problem that you're talking about is generally goes in the name of algorithmic bias. And I don't know how many people in the audience are aware of that term, but it's basically saying that if you build systems that are based upon historical data and are designed to recreate the same kinds of outcomes and decision-making that's been happened previously, to the extent that those old ideas and the old data were exhibited bias or discriminatory behavior, your system is going to do it as well. You're going to enshrine those bad behaviors in software that's distant, inscrutable, and it may be enshrined forever. So there's a lot of work going on in trying to understand what might be done about that. But the problem's in the data, it's not in the systems. And so if to the extent that it's being, these systems are being trained with data that does not exhibit these same kinds of discriminatory behavior, as John was saying, then it's going to be fine, basically, and those systems will not exhibit. They're not inherently evil, or they have no intention. They're not doing anything. They're just reflecting the same patterns that people have seen of the data that's being fed into.
So now it's time to jump to the question from the audience. Please introduce yourself and end the question with a question mark. We will add 7 more minutes as we started late. I hope people don't mind. So, yeah, lady over there.
Hello, everyone. I'm Anastasia Stepanova. I'm a software engineer from Facebook. So thank you for a lovely discussion. I truly enjoyed it. Thank you for moderating this. So the question is, how likely we as community can do to empower products in Ukraine? So there was mentioned a topic of soft skills, but what else? There might be, let's say, regulatory market for intellectual property. There might be more entrepreneurial programs to make sure people are comfortable with taking risks. There might be more partnership with investors. I want to hear a little bit more diverse perspective on this. What else can we do, what we haven't done before? Thank you.
I would love to see the Ukrainian government, the new government and the new parliamentary leaders give tax breaks to incentivize the prevalence of stock option ownership. The Ukrainian oligarchy isn't just the oligarchs that we see in the newspapers. It's the person that owns a 500-person IT outsourcing center in Uzhgorod and 100% owns that company. Recently, I had a meeting with the owner of a large IT outsourcing company. Every Ukrainian in IT knows this company. And he spent 45 minutes complaining about how spoiled his employees have become. Rising wages, increased competition for labor, all that. Later, my fiance saw him at Bao restaurant, which some of you know is an amazing Chinese restaurant in Kiev. And he came up to us and said, oh, hey, John, it's good to see you. Nice to meet you, Elizaveta. And then as he was leaving, my fiance says, hey, look, your friend has 2 bodyguards. I said, what? What does he need bodyguards for? And I was like, wow, yeah. He has 2 thuggish looking guys. And they got into this caravan of Porsches and left. And I said, honey, look at this. This is what pisses me off about this country. That guy just spent 45 minutes telling me how spoiled his employees are, yet he's the only one at this company that drives a Porsche, right? And so, you know, I would love to see the Ukrainian government and a lot of local business owners, Ukrainian business owners say, I want to give away part of the company, just the Ukrainian legislation doesn't support it, so what can I do? I gotta keep 100%, right? I mean, I want to be generous, but I can't, you know. So I would, and then, you know, a lot of people say, well, Ukrainians are illiterate about stock options. Just give them $150 a month more. How often do we hear that, right? So, but if the government could step up and say, look, here's a 4-year stock option plan. It's standard. It's tax-free. As long as your butt stays in Ukraine for the duration of that 48 months, you can withdraw that money when there's a liquidity event and that company IPOs or is acquired by Facebook or Google. And you can keep all of that money, right?
And I think it would do two things. One, it would spread the education of, hey, stock options are real. Our government supports it now. It's no longer this fantasy piece of paper that means nothing to me. And two, it would force the people, the secondary oligarchs, these people that make $1 million, $5 million, $10 million a year and own 100% of their companies, to start competing for labor by giving away equity, which we here in California know, you know, equity is how we buy our homes and retire. But in Ukraine, there's no 401k, there's no, you know, very little profit sharing, and there's no sense of stock option ownership. So I would love to see the parliament step up and make that happen. Some of them are here, let's do it, come on.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, that was, I would just go take one question from each row. That was a lady over there first.
Hi, my name is Irina Stetska. I'm Ukrainian. I've been in this country for 10 years, and I used to be one of those J2E engineers in services industry in Ukraine. And when I arrived to this country, I did not have the soft skills John mentioned, so thank you for saying this. And it's definitely true. It took me 10 years to get those soft skills and get the business skills. So these days, I work for Luhika, which is one of the major outsourcing companies in Ukraine. And I just want to clarify a little bit and then ask a question. So it's not all, outsourcing is what John, of course, mentioned. I'm here to support John, and I'm inspired by his story, because back when I lived in Ukraine 10 years ago, stories like that didn't exist. We didn't have Americans come to Ukraine and open product companies, so it's amazing that it's changed in these 10 years. I'm super thankful and pleased to hear that. I hope that it continues and we have more examples of that. I'm extremely inspired by the new generation of entrepreneurs and successful CEOs in Ukraine. Again, 10 years ago, it wasn't the case, so we definitely are seeing a positive trend. These days, I work with very successful companies in Bay Area, and we have relationships with VCs in Bay Area, so we work with a lot of A16Z-funded companies like Twilio, PagerDuty, Okta.
Sorry, can you come up to your question, because we have a lot
here?
Sure,
just a quick second. So every single day, I pitch Ukraine and the talent in Ukraine to all these successful companies. Unfortunately, I never hear from them that they want to go and open offices in Ukraine. They like working with Luhika, but they don't want to open product companies in Ukraine because the laws and regulation in Ukraine are not making it very welcoming and attractive for them. And so I guess, so I just wanted to comment on that, but my question is, how do we inspire the next generation of entrepreneurs like these guys who were on presenting, pitching their ideas today? Because it's not just about soft skills. Like, I'm seeing a positive trend, and I see most of engineers much better soft skills than they had 10 years ago, but it's not just soft skills. How do we inspire that entrepreneurial spirit, and most importantly, how do we drive VC funds to Ukraine? Because, you know, it's one thing just to run a startup and bootstrap it, but another thing, how do you actually make it to the stage that these guys are at, and how
Thank
do we
you.
Drive the VC funds to make it successful?
Thank you. Who wanna? Yeah, Vlad, and then Ivan.
Sure, yeah. I'll try to be quick with my answer. I think it's a bi-directional street. So we need not only those new guys which are coming from Ukraine and being successful at the global scale, and help them. Obviously, we can complain about the government, about the regulations, etc. But you know, the fact that we are here proves that it's possible, and it's not a rocket science. It takes hard work, but it's possible. So yeah, we need to embrace those guys to come out of this huge software outsourcing plast of our industry, you know, to become a product company. And they will be successful, because if they do this, they want that success. If they want that success, they'll be successful, at least some of them. But my point is that it should be also bi-directional, and we should really encourage this. We need more Johns coming to Kiev and Lviv and Kharkiv and Ukraine, you know, complaining reasonably, highlighting the problems, helping us to resolve those issues and grow. They grow with us, we grow with them. This is what I call collaboration.
Ivan?
I think it's really important idea that we really, really need to inspire entrepreneurship, you know, passion in Ukrainians, because people in Ukraine in general are risk averse. They don't want to risk failure. And I think the only realistic way to teach it is by example. And in this case, I totally mean by Ukrainian example, because, you know, you can show Ukrainians, any like Western professors, extremely successful businessmen, but they always can say, oh, okay, this, they are successful because they are not from Ukraine, right? You need to show them real Ukrainian founders. And in my experience, all the founders, successful at least founders in Ukraine, I know personally, they, when they started their startup, they knew somebody who was a founder, right? So I think we need more educational programs in Ukraine, not to, you know, for new set of lectures, but for personal interaction and inspiration face-to-face from Ukrainian founders to people who want to create a new startup or business in Ukraine.
Olena, you had a comment
and
on that.
I want to add another perspective. So we do need foreigners coming to Ukraine opening business, but we also do need more Ukrainians taking positions in international companies, in Facebook, in Google, in VC funds. We do need Ukrainians who work in these companies and take positions, and ideally leadership positions, of course. And also linking this to the previous questions from you, you're working in Facebook, right? So I think what would be really beneficial for Ukraine in general, and probably you could, I don't know, brainstorm something on this. Facebook doesn't have Ukrainian manager based in Ukraine on policy. And this is quite a problem for many countries, but also I think for such a big country as Ukraine, we do need a person devoted to Ukraine, ideally Ukrainian or knowing the language, and dealing with all the problems that Facebook has, for example, on propaganda side or election cycles. So if you can somehow advocate for this, I know there's already quite progress because this person will be based in Warsaw, but I mean, Warsaw and Kyiv are not far away, so I mean, it could be still in Kyiv. So.
I would just now take out my hat of the moderator and, you know, like add something on that. I believe that events like we are having today, and this tech and innovation panel, that's the thing that we need in order to build real bridges between Silicon Valley and Ukraine. And I really want the pledge from all of you sitting here. For the next year event, you should pledge bringing at least 3 people from your circle, business circle, or personal circle to this event and to this conference that never heard of Ukraine. It's up to you how you're gonna interest them. We will do a few teasers to help you with, but it's on us, you know, Ukrainians and people that love this country, to make it more visible here at the Silicon Valley. We have only 5 minutes left. What I would do, I have 3 questions here. I would collect them and we would answer them very briefly. Alex, then Makita, and Yaroslav. Like that's what I...
Hello, Alex Shapshin, Ukrainian politician. So like, I'm really happy that this panel is the last one and I'm not stressed to prepare for myself. Like, this is amazing panel, like, adore this and like, thank you very much. Like, I hope that you also one day will be proud of your Ukrainian politician as we're proud of our businessmen. We have a election period and it will be the parliament election, and let's imagine that you were reached by a leader or a member of one political party saying like, well, and you like this party, you like to help them to be promoted in the next parliament, and they said like, well, you are in Stanford, you are in California, you do a great business, like what advice could you give for us to promise and to realize it for, you know, to boost up tech and innovation, to have more entrepreneurs in Ukraine, so, but can you do the John style answer, you know, only one, like, huge but big advice, the many obstacles that you have. Okay. And also, I'm interested to listen also from these guys, not only from the panelists.
Yeah, okay. Makita? Yeah, we will collect.
Thank you. Makita Safronko, Ukrainian American Coordinating Council. So, as John mentioned, there's less racism, I guess, than was expected in Ukraine, but there is still a huge problem that can change the rules. It's sexism. Have you think there is a problem with it, and what is more important stuff, that how to boost Ukrainian ladies to become part of this game, and so they will be part of like development and to be leaders of Ukraine. Because as we can see even today on the panel, there was only one lady on their panel. So, and in parliament, there should be at least 50% of female representatives, and unfortunately, it's not like this right now. So hopefully in next elections, there will be a different situation. But more important is entrepreneurial, in female entrepreneurship in Ukraine, and what is done right now and what can be done. Thank you.
Yaroslav.
Thank you. So, Natalia, you were saying that, you know, next time we should bring our friends. And I was sitting today listening to very interesting panels and discussions. Thanks for putting this together. But I was thinking, like, what would really my American friends take out of this? And my impression is that many of these conversations are a little bit more Ukraine-centric than I would want them to be. I would want them to be more about, okay, not we, but hey, here is how you guys can benefit from what we have to offer. So since we have today interesting technology panel, but also many policymakers in the room, my question is, and it's also a question to everyone in the audience for you to think about it, is what can we do on the policy level, both in Ukraine and the United States, in order to build these bridges? And I'll tell you why. Because if we don't do this, going back to why this is important, right? If we don't do this, we're talking about the technological competition between two superpowers, the United States and China. And I do end up on the side of the argument that there is actually big rivalry between those two superpowers, and it's not all the AI is not like publicly available if you don't have the environment of serious scientists, and if you're not working in labs with Stanford, with Google, with other people, if you don't have the environment, you will be lagging behind. So if America does not impose their influence in Ukraine and have the symbiosis relationship, then maybe China or Russia will be the country that will do it. So what can we do on the policy level to ensure that happens? Thank you.
Yeah, we will have a very short answer. Who's going to take which question?
Well, about how can we empower more young women to be leaders? Like the co-founder of Allset here, super, super impressive stats. I mean, look, every Ukrainian knows that a lot of, not all, but there is a lot of young Ukrainian female students that believe their physical beauty is their primary equity. And I think one of the things that, and I don't know how to do this, but over time, I think one of the things that we should work on is destroying the princess industrial complex in Ukraine, right? I mean, there's so many smart young women, and their mothers and their grandmothers teach them, oh, you got an A in calculus? Why? You should be on a diet. And I think it starts with that, right? We have to fix that. When we fix that, I think you're gonna see some more, you know, co-founders of companies like Allset. And people like Sophia here, who also has an incredible AI startup.
Alex, question, who's gonna take it? Okay, Yaroslav. Yeah, you're gonna take Yaroslav.
Yeah, I will try your question. I think the most probably like, you know, fundamental way to build these bridges between Ukraine and the United States is to encourage more people and help more people to get an education in prominent American university, but with a strict commitment to return to Ukraine for at least 4 or 5 years after this, right? Government can do a lot because it can train people how this system works, how you can, you know, write application. They can finance each student
okay, maybe not each student, but the best students, right? And governments of many countries around the world already doing this program. So I think this is one thing that can be really powerful, because through the 1 year or 2 years or 4 years, you can, you know, build a lot of personal connections and then bring them back to Ukraine.
Vlad, I'm looking at you. You once actually were in the list of the political party that won parliamentary election, and you're supposed to be in the parliament, yep. And then you got back to your business.
Correct.
What is your idea? What, like, the parliament could do now for tech and innovation industry?
So, okay, my first comment would be like, don't touch something you can break, and just stay away from it. Don't try to regulate it. Don't try to put additional, you know, regulations and anything on this. I just don't think it's going to help a lot. My question, don't take it too general. My answer to that would be focus on justice and fight corruption. I know it sounds like, hey, make me happy, but seriously, those are two fundamental problems will help on all of the levels, because then we would have better people, you know, at the positions which would take care about, you know, fair regulations. You know, some of those guys will take care of the stock option, you know, legislation in Ukraine. The others would, you know, unlock this stupid inability to foreigners to come and work in Ukraine, because we still have limits which are harder than the green card here in the US. I mean, there are a ton of things like this, but I think if we all focus on those two fundamental things for our country, which is killing our country as a cancer, you know, corruption and justice. If we resolve this, the rest will come, because we are Ukrainians. We're pretty energetic people. We love to do things. We love to improve things. And if, like, if we have a field for that, we'll grow. The field will grow. The field will be green.
Yeah, Olena, your comment.
I just want to combine probably all three questions on dignity, rights, policy changes. So we not only do investments, we also do advocacy. And the project we are working now is called Digital Democracy Charter, which would unite probably all the digital rights in the new era that people unite. So since we are a policy conference, I think it could be nice mentioning this. So if any of our new and old leaders would love to implement it in Ukraine and to put it really into the position of being leading in international sphere, please do talk to me.
Thank you. I would not sum up this panel. I would ask now, you've heard a lot here, all of you, if you were to invest, would you consider Ukrainian startup after hearing all this? Just raise your hand.
Yes. Of course.
Okay, and now the last thing. I would ask Ukrainian founders or people that work for Ukrainian startups just to raise up. Come, come, come. They are my heroes, and they are the people that you should talk to, the one that raised their hand. Thank you all.